This is State Representative Kerry Condotta inviting you to watch our new and improved 12th District 2.0 show. Guests host John Wise and Shiloh Shower bring it all home with yours truly, Kerry Condotta.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Kerry Condotta, and this is the 12th District 2.0. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the 12th District. This is your state representative, Kerry Condotta, and it is election week. It is winding down finally, and I'll bet you're as glad as I am that it is. It's been quite a run, months and months and months of campaigning. A lot at stake in this particular election. If you haven't voted, I encourage you to do so, because what's at stake is control of the U.S. House, control of the U.S. Senate, control of the state house here in Washington, and control of the state senate. Also, huge potential changes in gun laws, huge potential changes and implications in taxes, including on gasoline and energy and groceries, and of course, a huge change in the use of force by our police departments based on Initiative 940. We will go a little bit more in depth again with each one of those initiatives later in the show. We're going to review the federal races, the state races, and then in the second segment, we will review the initiatives and the local races. We're going to wrap it all up right here on the 12th District when we return. We'll be right back.
At Town Nissan, we stand behind our products, we stand behind our customers, and of course, we always stand for the American flag. Come down to see us at Town Nissan behind Costco in East Wenatchee.
All right, well, we have arrived at election week and soon election day. It is just about over, and I think, like I said earlier, most of us are kind of glad that's happening. But it is a huge midterm election. Lots of potential changes depending on who controls the National House, the Congress, because it will change immigration policy. It will change tax policy, with the Democrats saying they'd roll back the tax cuts. It will certainly affect the trade policies, which are currently being decided across Europe and out through China. All these new trade policies are being worked on. That could certainly change. And of course, energy is something that is very much in the balance right now. So with all that said, let's see where we're at the federal level. Currently, the Republicans hold 238 seats to 197 Democrats. It would take a switch of 24 seats. Obviously, it's net one way or the other. If you lose one, you gain one. So 24 seats would change the power in the House, change the leadership and the committees. Of course, when one group takes over from the other, they control everything. So it's a big deal. And the fact is, those races are spread out across the country, but there are three major races right here. This is on the House side. And those three races are in the 3rd Congressional District, pitting Jamie Butler against Carolyn Long. This is down in the Longview, southwest area, Longview out to the coast and Vancouver. Those areas, it's a fairly condensed district, District 3. But Jamie Butler has held that seat for quite some time, is being challenged. As of the latest polling, Jamie does have a slight edge, but I guess we'll find out very soon. how that comes out. In the 5th District, Kathy McMorris, one of the leaders in the House Republican Party, is being challenged by Lisa Brown, former Democrat Senate leader here in the state of Washington, a formidable opponent, and putting on a very strong campaign. This one has been said to slightly favor McMorris, but it's been up and down. The polls have gone both ways. The one that's most close to our district and closest to us is a new district that was formed back under reorganization, redistricting, the 8th District, which is the only district that bridges eastern and western Washington. It's a very interesting district going all the way from Chelan County and East Wenatchee all the way over to almost Federal Way and down south to parts near Enumclaw. It takes in a lot of districts, of state districts within that 8th congressional district. And of course, that race is being called too close to call. Dino Rossi, who's well known in the Republican ranks, against a fairly unknown doctor named Kim Schreier. There could not be more difference between these two candidates. Dino Rossi, probably a slightly moderate Republican by some folks' feelings, and Kim Schreier, a pretty solid Seattle Democrat, will certainly be an interesting race to watch. And we might say that the 4th District here is probably a safe bet for the Republicans. Dan Newhouse, which is across the river here in Douglas County and on north and down to Tri-Cities. And that one looks pretty good. Now, we do have another race here. Let's go to the Senate side for a minute. The Senate side is 51. It's as close as it can get, really. It's 51 to 47 with two technical independents hanging out there. But those independents both tend to vote with Democrats. So, in effect, it's 51-49 in the National Senate. And there are a lot of races. There is one here. Senator Maria Cantwell is up versus former broadcaster Susan Hutchinson, former also state Republican chair. Now, that race originally was thought to be not that competitive, but I have to say Susan Hutchinson has done a pretty good job on her campaign and probably will do well. Will she get Maria Cantwell? That's not likely based on the polls we're seeing, but certainly putting up a much better effort than we expected. Now, if you look at the national scene, there is a big debate going on right now whether the House will flip or not. We've seen polls in both directions. But it is more solid on the Senate side that the Republicans could actually, at this point, pick up Senate seats once again. We'll be finding out shortly. But these are have huge implications on national policy going forward. Okay, in the state races, let's go to the state level. Current House is 48 Republicans and 50 Democrats. Again, about as close as you can get. One Republican pickup would create a tie at 49-49, but right now 48 to 50 in the House. The Senate is at 25 to 23, but there is one Democrat that caucuses with the Republicans. That's Tim Sheldon out of the 35th District. And he is in a very, very tight race. So, and there are several Senate races that are very, very tight. Let's take a look at where those battlegrounds are. I think this is not something we report much on. We talk about our own district, but let's look across the state and see where the battlegrounds are. Is it really urban versus rural? Well, not necessarily. There's some interesting battlegrounds that are kind of in the middle. In the Senate races, the Senate seats that are most at risk for the Republicans are in District 30, which is Federal Way, District 42, which is Bellingham, District 26, which is Bremerton, District 47, which is Kent and Auburn. And to some extent, the other interesting race is District 35, as I mentioned earlier, Tim Sheldon, Democrat versus Democrat. Now, Tim Sheldon, again, is caucusing with the Republicans, has for some time. That's part of how the Republican Senate coalition was formed. And the fact is, he is in a very tight race after being an incumbent for years with an opponent that is a standard Democrat would actually caucus with a Democrat. So that could create a definite shift. Any of these races, if all these went to the Democrats, it would be a huge seismic shift in the state Senate and would certainly change the look of Olympia. In the House, let's take a look. There are a number of seats in play. The battlegrounds here are similar, as you would expect. There is some overlap between the Senate and the House. Probably the most hard-fought battle is District 19. That's Aberdeen-Hoquiam area, where the Republicans picked up a seat for the first time in 40 years, just 2 years ago, and that seat is under huge fire from the Seattle folks. They are pouring a ton of money down into that area. Right now, the polling still shows the Republicans holding that seat, but it's really too close to call. The other battleground, District 5, which is right in the heart of Issaquah and North Bend, there are two Republican seats there that are too close to call. Also up in Bellingham, we talked about the Senate seats. There are two House Republican seats up there that are equally challenged. And again, in District 26, so you can see the overlap of some of these. Now, there's another district that's challenged. That's 25, Puyallup. The Senate is not up for election there, but the House is. And both those are open seats. Kind of unusual to have two open seats in one district. But that has been a very interesting battleground throughout. On a second-tier level, there are some other challenges. Certainly, District 10, Whidbey Island, showed some weakness in the primary for the Republicans. And the Castle Rock Longview area, District 18, long held by the Republicans, is under challenge again down south. And again, next to that district, District 17 in Vancouver, is always a battleground area. It's been back and forth from Democrats to Republicans, and right now it looks like the Republicans are holding a slight edge. In eastern Washington, the only district that was of question in the primaries was District 6. There is an open seat in District 6. And right now the polling shows the Republicans again holding that, but by a very, very slim margin. Again, that has been a Republican-controlled district for some time. Now, there's a couple of interesting anomalies here that are happening. In District 13, just south of us in Ellensburg, we have Matt Manweller, who has decided he will resign his seat after the election. Now, the reason for that is, we won't get into the details of his situation, but by staying in the race, if he wins, if he's voted in, then the Republicans will keep control of that seat and be able to assign someone to that position. If Matt Manweller should lose to his Democrat opponent, then there will be a Democrat in that seat for the first time, and as long as anybody can remember, I think there's a good chance Matt Manweller will hold on, because that is the second most Republican district in the state of Washington, and I think the folks down there see the implication, regardless of whether Matt Manweller moves forward or not, and it looks like at this point he will not move forward. I have heard there's already 5 to 6 people that would like that position in the 13th. Last but not least, right here in the 12th district, we have a very interesting situation. A lot of money's been spent from a lot of outside interest on an independent, and we'll see how it goes. But the problem with an independent, folks, is in the House of Representatives, if you're an independent, you don't have a caucus, you don't have a staff. You don't even technically have committees. You're lucky to get a seat on the floor. And that's why no independent has ever been elected in over 100 years. It's unfortunately not functional at this point. Now, if there was enough of them, if there were several, they could form their own caucus, I suppose, and at some point have a staff. But right now, it would be a very dysfunctional position. Also, very detrimental to the budgets. Transportation and capital budgets are done by the caucuses. They are discussed among the leadership, and therefore that person would be left out. So let's hope that Republicans hold the 12th district at this point and remain a part of the legislature, not an outside source with virtually no power whatsoever. All right, there's the federal and state issues. Let's come back and talk about the initiatives. This is a big deal. These are huge initiatives with huge implications. We'll be right back to discuss each one of those briefly, review them, and tell you what we think about them. We'll be right back.
Get the fastest internet available in North Central Washington by switching to Localtel and get speeds up to 1,000 meg. Call 888-8888 today or go online to localtel.net.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Thanks for hanging with us. We are reviewing the final review, actually, of the candidates, federal, state, local, and some initiatives that are on this ballot. We are wrapping it up because this cycle is almost through. I might mention that NCW Life will have election coverage on Tuesday night from 7:30 to 9 o'clock. I will be a part of that broadcast. We'll be taking a look at the results. I encourage you to tune in. That's on NCW Life at 7:30 on election night, November 6th. All right, let's take a look at those initiatives real quickly. Some big, big movers. Initiative 940, very controversial use of force. You heard our show about it, hopefully, with my friend who's a police officer and a state representative, David Hayes, told you that there is already a pre-negotiated change, a better bill that is sitting on the table in Olympia if this one fails. There will be a bill addressing this issue, but it won't go quite as far as 940, which has some pretty terrible implications for police officers and could really create a problem in hiring police officers throughout the state of Washington. They may want to go other places. So 940, hopefully a no, hopefully does not pass. The legislature has agreed to build a better bill. in the next session, and I think that's a solid agreement because last time we did it, unfortunately, technically couldn't get it done. All right, 1631, millions being spent on both sides of this. This is the so-called carbon tax. They don't call it that. They call it a pollution tax, but the fact is it is a carbon tax. This will have a lot of implications, primarily on the cost of energy. We'll be raising the cost of energy substantially. Your power bill will go up. We find that rather interesting since Washington is the cleanest producer of power anywhere in the United States. We put out more megawatts with less carbon than anybody, especially since the coal plant is just about finished up over on the other side. That makes us nearly a carbon-free producer, and yet we want to tax our energy. Makes no sense to me and a lot of folks. Of course, the opposite side saying oil companies are buying this, that's not necessarily true. It's just not a very well-written initiative, and frankly, it doesn't get the result it wants. The worst part about it is it also raises the gas tax. Now, will that make people drive less? Oh, possibly, but it's just another gas tax. And all this money from energy and taxes goes to an unelected board of people who get to decide where it's spent. The legislature really doesn't have a lot of oversight in this bill. This bill is not well written. It is not going to achieve what it needs to. As a matter of fact, it's got a built-in safety that if it doesn't achieve, the taxes keep going up. So there is a built-in failure device that increases the taxes as long as carbon doesn't come down. Very unusual. Hopefully you're voting no on that particular issue. There are better ways to solve the carbon issue, and we've seen a lot better ways. All right, 1634, the most confusing initiative on the ballot because of the yes, no, it's kind of reversed. I've had a tremendous amount of inquiries on my Facebook page as well as through email and other sources asking, which way does this thing go? Well, a yes says no more taxes on groceries, puts a ban on any further taxes on groceries statewide, leaves Seattle alone, can keep their current soda tax, but can't increase it. A no vote is saying, nope, we'll leave it wide open, let the cities decide. That is a little bit counterintuitive, so a yes vote for most folks would be no new taxes, and a no vote would be tax me some more. So hopefully that comes out right. The polling has been kind of confusing, and I think it's because people are confused. So let's make sure you read that one thoroughly. And last but not least, one that's very close to the folks here in the 12th District, a very high gun ownership rate here with virtually no gun crime, and yet 1639 would put severe restrictions and changes on gun owners throughout the district and throughout the state. Again, analysis on both sides. Will it save lives? Probably not. Will it create some inconveniences? Yes. Are there pieces of this that are probably worthwhile? Yes, probably. There are probably a few things in here that are reasonable. The problem is there's 17 different pieces in this initiative, and frankly, some of them aren't even considered constitutional. So I would say at this point, we hope that fails, but it'll also be challenged if it doesn't. All right, on the local candidate basis, we've got some pretty hot races. Chelan County Commission, Sean Smith versus Bob Boogert is an interesting race, a Republican versus a, quote, independent again. Obviously, we know who's on which side there. There's some late-breaking news that has come out about Sean, and I don't think it's personally a problem, but some people do, so we'll see how that turns out. That is going to be a very well-contested race. On the Douglas County side, both candidates are campaigning. Mark Straub, Norm Tupling. It looks like Mark has the edge there. Again, we'll see in the results. But that completes a complete changeover in the Douglas County Commission in the last couple of years. We will have a completely new set of commissioners. And Chelan County is moving that direction, too, with the final veteran coming up in 2020, which is Division 3 of the Chelan County Commission. And now we get into some more anomalies. A very unusual situation in the Chelan County Sheriff's race. A write-in candidate that came in late got on the ballot and has actually put on quite a campaign. And there is truly a race between Brian Burnett and Jennifer Tyler. And it'll certainly be interesting to see how that comes out, given how she approached the ballot and got on the ballot and the reason behind it. So quite an interesting situation there. I don't think there's anything quite like it anywhere else in the state. It is certainly turned out to be more of a contest than I think anyone expected. Judges, Superior Court, what a race this has been with Travis Brandt and Robert McSevendy. But the interesting twist is that Robert McSevendy took another job, basically resigned and moved on to another job. But that does not leave it open. Travis Brandt still has to win that race to get it, or it will be another appointment. Now, remember, Robert McSevendy was assigned by Jay Inslee, was appointed by Jay Inslee, as was Kristen Ferrara on the other side. And that could happen again if Travis Brandt doesn't win. In the second position, Charles Steinberg, a local 24-year person who's been here all his life, had his practice here all his life, versus a, relatively newcomer. She's been here a while, but Kristen Ferrara, who was appointed by Jay Inslee and is backed by all 9 Supreme Court justices, which may or may not tell you something. We'll see. And District Court, of course, Alan Blackman and Kyle Mott dueling off. We'll see how that goes. There you have it. That's the lineup. That's what you're voting on, folks. I hope you take the time and effort to vote. These are major changes locally and state, particularly the state level. This could really shift the balance of power to the Seattle folks, who have really put a huge effort into taking the legislature this year. And, of course, at the federal level, it means so much. We'll be right back to wrap it up, and we'll have the last word of the day.
Are you wanting high-speed internet but don't have access to PUD fiber? Try SkyFi high-speed wireless internet from Localtel. Call 888-8888 today.
Well, folks, that's it. We're wrapped up another election season. We're going to move on to other subject matter. And don't forget, we'll be in Olympia. Well, at least we'll be transmitting back and forth from Olympia during the session. You'll have a weekly update right from the source in Olympia when we get there. Don't forget also election night coverage on November 6th. It'll be later on. We'll have it 7:30 to 9 o'clock. I'll be joining that election night coverage. We'll get all the results of this incredible cycle. We'll see where the federal government lands, where the state government lands, and where our local situation lands. And the last word of the day, folks, is the most important word of probably this year, given what's on the line, and that's vote. If you haven't voted, get out and do it now. Fill out that ballot. And by the way, the sooner you turn in the ballot, those phones will quit ringing and those emails will quit coming because they'll quit bothering you. The get out the vote right now is one of the biggest efforts by both sides we've ever seen, and you're likely to get 8 to 10 emails and phone calls until you get that ballot turned in. So go do it. Once again, the last word of the day, vote. This is Kerry Condotta, your state representative. Yes, for a few more months. It doesn't end with the election. I'll be around until the end of the year and then beyond that reporting from Olympia next year here on the 12th District 2.0. Thanks for being with us.
Video you'd like to see featured on NCW Life? Email us at newsphotos@ncwlife.com.